Ephesians chapter 6, we are looking at looking at the armor of God, and there's a reason that that armor is very important. And we last time did part one, kind of verses 10 through 12, and today we're going to continue on and do a kind of a part two to that. We ask the question, is Satan and his demonic forces active in our world today? Well, I think we see evidence of that. We talk about and pray about people in cities like Mosul and Aleppo. The news told about ISIS in Mosul taking over a bakery. And there were six men working in the bakery. ISIS put all six men in the oven and baked them like bread, executed them that way. And it doesn't stop there. ISIS brought in 250 children and put them through the bread dough kneading machine and killed them that way. And I don't know about you, but I'm saying, that's terribly evil. So you and I see evidence of Satan and his forces. How about in our nation? Is there evidence in our nation that Satan is working? Well, if you watched your news the last few days, you saw that there are witches all around the world that are teaching people to repeat and to cast a spell against our current U.S. government, against our President Trump and against his cabinet and against anything they want to accomplish. And they go through this whole ritual on the internet, how you can help them cast this spell and try to negatively affect anything that they might try to accomplish. Yeah, direct appeal to demonic forces. Are these evil forces at work in our culture? Well, yes, I think we can see that. We have confusion over lots of issues, marriage, gender, all kinds of things that didn't really even used to have. Are these evil forces at work in your neighborhoods and our schools? Yes. Are they at work in our families? I don't know about you, but does it ever seem like, especially if you have children, a family to get ready to come on Sunday morning and go to church, does it ever seem like Sunday morning is the most difficult time to get this family together and ready to go? I mean, it might be later than school day or work day, but it just seems to be a difficult morning. My parents, thank God, were committed to taking us to church as a family every Sunday. My dad was a farmer. And of course, he had all kinds of animals to help as they gave birth and all kinds of things. And my dad used to say, you know, on Sunday morning, I think even the bull could have a calf. And it was just reflecting his frustration that how much happened on Sunday morning. And yet I praise God, he was faithful to take us to church. And really, all three of us have continued that kind of commitment. So, you know, Satan is, and his demonic forces are at work, hindering us every turn and every way they can. And they're trying to affect our individual spiritual lives. And we want to talk a little bit more about that today. So, Satan and his demonic forces work to deceive us and to hinder us from being spiritually victorious. We just sang, "It is well with my soul." That upsets Satan and his demonic forces. They do not want anything to be well in your soul. They want you to be troubled and worried and frustrated and stressed out and overwhelmed and all of that. They are our enemy. Jeannie played, I believe, "Turn Your Eyes upon Jesus." No, Satan and his demonic forces do not want you to turn to Jesus and have faith in his care for you or whatever. They don't want that, and they work to hinder it. So, in this second part of our study, we want to think about how does Satan strategize to attack us personally. We need to understand his methods so that we will be better prepared to defeat him. Quick review, being this is part two. Last time, we looked about being strong, putting on the armor of God. That was two Sundays ago, coming from verse 10. "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, the power of his might." And then, He's commanded us to be spiritually strong. He has provided us everything we need to be spiritually strong. So today, don't get depressed thinking about all the ways that Satan wants to attack us. We have the armor of God. We are in Jesus Christ. We have the most spectacular position in Christ. We have supernatural power, same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead if we allow the Holy Spirit to control us in the context, Ephesians 5:18. And we're provided the spiritual armor, which we'll get into in the Sunday, in the future Sundays. Satan is strategizing against us. Yes, we have a powerful enemy, and we are in a spiritual battle against supernatural forces. And God wants us to know that. And so verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles. We looked at the strategies. Stratagem is the word. The strategic plans consistently of the devil against us. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. That is where the real battle is. Folks, what you and I see with our eyes, what we experience with our senses, what we look in the media and see happening around the world, is just a part. That's not true reality. That's not the total picture. And of course, you and I live in a culture in the West which tries to defend a closed system, that there is no supernatural beyond that. But the Bible tells us different, and we have experienced and know that it's different. Reality is, there is a supernatural. There is God, his angels, Satan, and the demons, and they are at war with one another and with us as believers and with the church. And we need to be aware of that. Otherwise, we are going to be broadsided. We're going to be surprised because Satan has all these strategies against us. So we need to be aware of that. Now, today, we want to see that Satan's forces strategize to get us to give them some control in our life. After Satan has lost his hold on your eternity, he does all he can to inhibit our spiritual victory. We have seen this chart. Very important. Justification is where we start, up here. This is the point when we come to faith in Jesus Christ and our relationship changes. We become a new creature. We become in Christ. We have heaven as our home, promised by God. That is a major change. We have been justified. We have been given the righteousness of Jesus Christ from his death on the cross, where he paid the penalty for our sin. And we are on the road to heaven, and nothing can take that from us. Satan lost the battle when you put your faith in Jesus Christ. He lost you as a captive. He lost the ability to take you to hell with him. Well, he's not happy about that. And he's not going to just go off and lick his wounds and say, well, let them be. No, now you and I are in this sanctification process. Over here, experientially, positionally, we are sanctified. That's why Paul calls us saints. We've seen that throughout the book of Ephesians and other books. But you and I are experientially now trying to live like saints. We have the Holy Spirit's power in us. He wants to give victory in our lives. He wants us to be a good testimony. He wants us to serve faithfully as a representative of Jesus Christ, ambassadors, Paul calls us. Sharing the message, the gospel message, and the victory that people can have. And that's where Satan can work. He cannot affect our glorification. That's promised because of our justification. We know that someday we will be in heaven. We will be glorified. We will have a brand new body, which will be no longer tempted or subject in any way to sin. He can't affect that. But what he can affect is my life and yours on a daily basis. And that's where he wants to inhibit us and hinder us and trip us up and so on. So, Satan is trying to rob believers of the spiritual blessing God has given to them. And we need to be aware of the ways in which he does that. Verse 3 of chapter 1 of Ephesians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. You and I have every spiritual blessing that we need. We have this Word of God. This Word of God tells us that it is all we need to live a righteous life, a victorious Christian life. We have it. There's nothing that God has left out. There's nothing lacking. He's even given us the Holy Spirit's power to control our life and help us to do that. But Satan wants to get in there and influence and keep us and steal that victory. if any way possible. Now, when we say Satan, last time we talked about Satan being a created being. He's not like God. He's not everywhere. He's at one place at one time. You and I probably never have met Satan personally, but he has all these demonic forces that he uses in that big hierarchy. And we see that from verse 13, against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of the age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. They are the ones, the evil forces, we'll call them, satanic forces that are trying to hinder us. Now, Satan and his demonic forces seek to gain a stronghold in our lives. Let me begin by saying that there's a balance in how we approach this whole area of demonic activity. And, you know, we can go to one of two extremes. There are some, we don't want to follow that extreme, to see Satan under every rock and everything that happens in your life. When your refrigerator breaks down, Satan's in it. And all of these things, okay? I've been in a church where they struggle with the copier machine and, you know, Satan must live in here. No, I don't think so. They're joking about that. So, you know, that's one extreme to see. And people walk around with a t-shirt, you know, Satan made me do it. No, not really, especially if you're a believer. He can't make you do anything. You choose. And so that's one extreme. But the opposite extreme is probably where a lot of American Christians are. And that's they just aren't aware. They just discount the whole thing. Maybe Satan does things in other parts of the world, but, you know, I'm not really aware of what he's doing in my life. And so that is the other mistake. We would be foolish to dismiss the possibility that these demonic forces are affecting us in some ways. All of us, as we mentioned last time in the West, have been somewhat sheltered by our Judeo-Christian heritage and so on. Some of us experience more sheltered life than others. Many of us are unaware of the spiritual battle going on around us. Many of us are unaware of the spiritual battle in which we and our loved ones are involved. And we need to talk about that today. Let's talk a moment about demon possession. There's always a question that comes up. Well, can a believer be possessed by a demon? We know that Jesus, in his time on earth, there was a lot of demonic activity, probably a heightened amount because he, the Son of God, was there, and the Word of God, and they knew who he was, and they were afraid of him, and so on. And he would command them to go out, and so on. Lots of demonic activity. Lots of people that he set free from being possessed by a demon. Can a believer be possessed by a demon? I would say no. Now, you might say, well, this is maybe a discussion in semantics of terms. But possessed, no. The Holy Spirit lives within you as a believer and within me. And a demonic force and the Holy Spirit are not going to live the same place. So I would say a believer cannot be possessed, but we use a different term. A believer can be obsessed. We can give areas of our life as openings to Satan's demonic forces. And they don't have control over. They cannot come to you and demand that you do this or you give this area of your life to sinful, their sinful habits or their desires. They can't demand that, but they can trick you and invite you. And if you do give them influence, they'll take it and they'll use it against you. So we need to draw that difference up front. Now, Satan can target us in various ways. If you've placed your faith in Jesus Christ for eternal life, you are a child of God. The Holy Spirit lives within you. You're no longer a captive of Satan and his forces, and we don't need to fear that. But they can trick us into believing a lie and giving them some control of our life. Now, we're familiar with armies and navies and trying to land on a country's beach that they want to take. We think of our own U.S. forces landing on Omaha Beach on France and the tremendous loss of life and risk they took against the enemy machine guns on the cliffs, trying to land. And why was that so important? That's important because we need a beachhead. We need a place where we can gather and go out and fight from. If you go to Russia and you think of the Second World War there, it lost way more people, by the way, than we did. And I've been able to tour Volgograd, and that's their Omaha Beach. That's where they lost a tremendous amount of life. And basically, the city of Volgograd was falling to the Germans. And Russia, the Russian troops, half of them didn't even have weapons. They were giving everything to hold the last 60 feet of shoreline before the Volga River. And I said, you know, why was that so important? Why did they lose so many lives just to protect that 60 feet? And the Russians will explain to you, you see, this is a major river. You see the ships going up and down this river, oil tankers, all kinds. They supply Moscow. And everybody knew that if the Germans could make it to that river, they could shut down that traffic and Moscow would fall. And so the enemy wants to find a beachhead that he can land and a little bit of territory in your life and mine that he can control and use against us and operate from that against us. They want to establish some area within our lives which they can use. Now, how do they do that? They try to get us to believe a lie. How do we do that? How do we open ourselves up to that? Well, there are things that you and I maybe think are not that serious, innocuous. You know, we maybe dabble with things that have some occultic touch. There are games, Ouija boards, and all that kind of stuff out there. There's spells, which we just talked about. They're putting on the internet. There's things like that. The areas of our life of sin, pornography, all these things can be an area, a beachhead, from which satanic forces can operate against us and attack us and hold us or a part of our life captive. And we need to be careful about those things. I told you last Sunday, that, you know, some of us are sheltered. I remember talking to pastors who deal with people who struggle with this. And in describing what he's doing and so on, he looks at me and says, Lonnie, you don't know what I'm talking about, do you? Well, no, I don't. And that's because, and he lists off of, you know, how sheltered a life I've had growing up in a Christian family. And one of the things he says is there's no, you know, divorce, no suicide, these kinds of things. Well, there came a time later on when my grandfather, who I know is a believer, heard his testimony many times, took his own life. And my family, my mother and her brother and sister, asked me to do the funeral. And so in preparation for that, I said, okay, a couple questions. Number one, are we going to be honest about the fact that Grandpa took his own life? And they talked about that and decided, yes, we're going to be honest. So we were. And people appreciated that. In fact, people came up after the end of the service and said, we're glad you were really honest about what your loved one did. We weren't honest. We hid it. You know, our loved one did the same thing, but none of us talk about it. The second thing I did was warn them. I said, you know, the fact that Grandpa, a patriarch in this family, has chosen seriously to go to heaven and stand before God's throne uninvited, that's pretty serious. Think about evaluation day and so on. That can have an effect on the rest of us. We need to be warned. We need to be careful. For one, just humanly speaking, it makes it a bit more acceptable, you know, for some grandchild or great-grandchild to say, well, if Grandpa did it, it'd be okay for me too. And just the demonic opening that that kind of thing makes, we need to be careful. We need to live on guard. We need to know. So those are things that we need to be careful of. Then Satan's forces use false teaching to deceive us. Cults deceive people by teaching them lies about reality. Most cults are not going out to make new members from paganism. Most cults target church people. They will tell you that. That 70-80% of our cult once went to a Christian church. They teach false, deceptive, subversive teaching and want to attract you to join them as a group and follow their leader. They target us. They're not out there evangelizing for their cause. They target us. One of my own distant relatives was in Jonestown following Jim Jones and drank the Kool-Aid that took all their lives. Deceived, following a leader, obeying him and his commands no matter what. You say, well, okay, I'm not in a cult, but their false teaching is all around us. And we are affected by it as well. All kinds of ways. Media, things that, you know, that we hear, we need to be careful. My wife went to a hairdresser some time ago, and first time, just tried this new hairdresser. And he's talking to her about, you know, I could really help you. I could help you with stress and massage and teaching you how to think differently and give you the strength, the power to, you know, kind of be against this stressful life and things that happen in our lives. And he invites her to a special session where just he and her can get together and do this. And he's trying to teach her how to channel, channel a demonic force, a spirit. And she recognizes some of this and finds out that he's into something which she and I had never heard of this. Reiki, it's called. And, you know, Reiki, in 2006, there were 60 million Reikians and 19 million websites about various forms of this. In 2013, a Google search for Reiki returned 55 million results. Reiki masters invite people to be like Jesus, they say, by also becoming a Reiki master. And what they are doing is trying to use energy, power, trying to transfer power. And they promise that it will heal and it will help you in your life and so on. But there's rituals they go through. There's insignias that they worship. All of this, a way to channel spiritual power. They lay hands on you and they try to channel this Reiki energy. This is made possible, these masters, by paying a large sum of money to have this power and this ability. When healing occurs, they give glory to Reiki, saying, oh no, I can't heal you, but Reiki did, and their masters. They can transfer power by writing a Reiki symbol and calling the name of the spirit of the symbol three times. They can give the receiver a revelation. The Reiki masters have a calling to get as many people connected to Reiki as possible. They're paid to do this. The word Reiki basically means a supernatural knowledge or spiritual consciousness used as a personal life force. This is to activate, or their goal is to activate, in uniting the universal with the personal and the divine psychic awareness with manifestation and healing. Does that sound familiar? The Bible calls that divination. And it's an abomination. And God judges it strongly. This is linked with sorcery and enchantments and other practices. These are forbidden attempts to learn knowledge which God has not chosen to reveal to us. These practices invite demon spirits of various names and symbols to open accesses for these spirits so energy can flow through this person, through people's lives. You can go on the internet and read testimonies of people who were trapped by this deception and were set free by the power of Jesus Christ. Reiki is intended to open people up to demonic spirits in an attempt to gain supernatural power. Now, this sounds familiar from the whole New Age movement. The whole New Age movement teaches a person how they can become a god, right? They define sin as your inability or your block in your knowledge to realize that you are your own god. Buddhism tries to teach people to become God. Mormonism teaches people to become the God of their own planet. This should sound familiar if you read Genesis 3. Satan wants to be God. And that's what caused him to fall, and that's what he uses in our lives as well. We want to control our own destiny. Islamic writings say that Allah is the greatest, that's their name for God, Allah, okay? Is the greatest of all deceivers because he deceives those who do not believe in Islam. Therefore, it's very desirable, if you're in Islam, to deceive infidels as a means to the end of destroying them. They worship a god or celebrate the fact that their god deceives, lies. And it's okay. It's okay for them to lie, to deceive, as long as the end is to destroy infidels. That philosophy, and not just outside of even religious settings, we have political groups and parties today who believe the end justifies the means. It doesn't matter how truthful you are or true to reality as long as the goal is reached. The end justifies the means, a philosophy coming from this false teaching. So, you and I can be affected by these philosophies and false teaching, even if we're not involved in a cult that's woven into our culture and media and so on. And we need to be careful, do we not? We need to learn to filter everything we read and hear and watch on media and the movie films and yes, the children's films, Disney films, all of that. They all teach a certain philosophy. They all teach a certain lesson. And we need to train our families, our children, and us to filter everything by God's word. I remember sitting down when my daughters were young, and we'd watch something together, a Disney movie or whatever, and enjoy it. But then afterwards, we'd say, Christy, Kimberly, what did this story teach? What do you think they were trying to say? What do you think they want you to walk away from this movie with? And we discuss that. Is that biblical? Is that what God says in the Bible? Why is it different? And we have to teach ourselves to think critically and use God's word as a filter, or else we are affected by this deception. Now, thirdly, satanic forces deceive us personally. Jesus described Satan as the father of lies. This is one of his names, John 8:44. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Satan is a master liar, a master deceiver. And he's had some 6,000 years of practice. And he's trained his demonic forces well. And they are out to deceive us. Well, how? First of all, he tries to force us to believe a lie. He tempts us. Demonic forces offer you a short-term thrill. Someone lately just illustrated that or related that to a drug dealer. Here's some free drugs. Try them. You'll have a wonderful experience. They know it's addicting. They know they want to get you trapped. They know it will bring them lots of money and lots of power. Satan tries to tempt us with some short-term pleasure. Oh, no one will know. No one will find out. No one will get hurt. It's okay. Everybody else does it, you know? And he tries to get us hooked. He wants us to get on the end of his fish line. He wants to have a control. He has something he can use against us. If we play with something demonic just because we're intrigued by it, that does not make it safe or innocent or remove its consequences. They are great. You know, I think about traps and trapping animals. Animals have freedom. They can run, you know, miles. But placed in the trap is some bait. Something that would taste good to that animal. And the animal give up his freedom for that short-term taste of that food. That's what Satan wants to do to you and to me. He wants us to be under his control. He cannot control us as believers. He cannot enforce that. He cannot make you do something, but he tempts you to give him that control. We must learn to use the filter of God's word. We especially need to filter everything that we see and gets communicated around us. This lie will affect our life until we renounce it. We'll talk more about the armor and how we deal with that later. Our whole life can be affected by a lie. You all know, you've heard stories, maybe you've experienced it, maybe you know people, children who hear a significant person in their life, maybe a parent, or maybe a teacher in school, or maybe someone they look up to, maybe even an older brother or sister. And if that child hears things like, you are good for nothing. You are a failure. You can't do anything right. Those things get repeated over and over in their mind. That can affect their entire life. They believe that lie, and it changes them. It affects them. Satan knows how to do that to you and to me. So Satan's forces try to capture us by lying to us. They tell believers, oh, you're not really a believer. You got to be kidding. Look what you just said. Look what you did. Look what you just thought. That's not what a believer does. You can't be a believer. You're not on your way to heaven. You're on your way to hell with us. If they can convince you of that, they can shake your entire security, your entire assurance. And they use all kinds of ways to do that, all kinds of messages, all kinds of good intending people using the Word of God. Try to question your security that Paul works hard in Ephesians, the first part of the book, to assure us that we have. That's our solid basis. Our relationship in Christ is everything about our life is built on that. And so Satan goes after that. And he would love for everyone to question that. That has a negative effect upon our spiritual victory. Sometimes he tells us you cannot have spiritual victory. Maybe there are some special Christians who are really strong and committed and okay, yeah, you can look up to them. But that's not you. I mean, that's never going to be you. I mean, you're just a common person. You're just normal. You're going to continue to struggle with these things the rest of your life. And he gives excuses, right? Look at your mom and dad. Look at your ancestors. Look at the situation you're in. You didn't have the chance other people have. You're trapped in this. That's where they want us. And they want us to believe that. And as long as we believe it, it has a very devastating effect on our spiritual victory. Maybe the power of the Holy Spirit helps some believers, but not me. If you're convinced of that, then you will never let him control you. They remind us of something in your past, some sinful, some failure, something, and they remind us consistently, you're a liar, you're a thief, you're irresponsible, you let people down, you are whatever it is in the past, and they want that to be your identity. Now, of course, the Bible tells us to admit our sin, our wrong. We don't deny it. We don't cover it up. We don't say, no, I never did anything wrong. That was me. Okay, I did that. But that's no longer me. The Bible, especially Ephesians, works hard to say you're a new creature. You have all the spiritual blessings and benefits of being related in Christ to God, seated in the heavenlies. I was that. I'm no longer that. Do I still blow it? I still blow it. But that's not my identity. My identity is a believer. My identity is a saint. I'm positionally righteous. I'm trying to, bring my life and live my life up to that. But as long as we accept that that's you, that's always you, you will never get away from that. That's your identity. That's a lie from Satan. And he holds us back. And he says, you're never going to have spiritual victory. You're not going to make anything good out of yourself. You can't get past this. You can't get over this. Whatever the limitation is. And he lies to us about that. And we need to say, no, that's a lie of Satan. Satan's forces attempt to influence our behavior by deceiving us. Those satanic, evil, dark forces, as Paul calls them in these verses, they want to destroy your marriage. They don't want a marriage reflects God's Trinity, God's glory. Man was made in God's image. Marriage reflects the fellowship within the Trinity. Two individuals being one together. A husband's love for his wife, unconditional, reflects Jesus Christ's life, love for the church. Satan doesn't want that. He doesn't want you to be a picture reflecting God. And he is out to destroy your marriage and mine. And we better know it. We don't fight against flesh and blood. My enemy is not my mate. It is satanic forces. That's where the battle is waging. And, too many people, too many couples believe that marriage is a romantic balcony experience. It is not. It is a battlefield. And you and I, and my mate and I better be united on this battlefield to fight against spiritual forces that are trying to destroy us. We better be aware of that. And we need to fight hard. I saw a book entitled lately, I can't quote it totally, but the title is something like, What If Marriage Wasn't About My Happiness? What if marriage's tension was about my sanctification? Where we grow together and being linked to a mate and living together, we're challenged to grow and become a different person because married life, family life, brings out our weaknesses. And we see that in each other, and we need to deal with that and grow. Yeah, God wants to use our marriage to help us. We need to remain strong together. The enemy says, that's your partner's fault. Everything is your partner's fault. I mean, you'd be so much happier if that partner were different. In fact, that partner really doesn't meet your needs anymore the way you hoped they did, so it's time to find a new one. That's the world's culture. They have bought into this lie that Satan and his demonic forces have, and you and I, that rubs off on us. We hear that, we start to think that. We dare not think that. We need to know where that comes from, and we need to condemn that lie. With the lie, some people believe, well, if I really disciplined my children and tried to help them become the person that they ought to be, I mean, they wouldn't consider me their best friend anymore. And I don't want to upset that. I don't want to befriend. I want them to be my best friend. That's what's most important. And so we don't follow God's training and train up our children to follow Him, which involves discipleship and discipline. We don't take that responsibility. The demonic forces are out to destroy your children and your grandchildren. According to Romans 1, everything we see in our culture, all the confusion about sexual issues and marriage and gender issues and all, are a judgment of God against people who refuse to acknowledge Him as the Creator. The faith of our children is being undermined at every way possible. We need to know the public school, by and large, is not on our side. The media is not on our side in these things. How many of you went this week and saw the Is Genesis History? Okay. Ah, it was wonderful. Truth, reality, the Bible. One of the things that was that impressed me is that by attacking the truth of the Genesis creation story, they can destroy everything else the Bible has to say because it's all based on that. It undermines the gospel. If there were no fall, if Adam and Eve weren't literal people, if there was no fall, then there's no sin, there's no responsibility, no morality. I mean, it undermines everything. And our culture is saturated with it. Satan is trying to deceive you, your children, your grandchildren about all of that. They are being told they can do anything they want. Children today, you can grow up and do anything you want to, especially in this country. You can be anything you want to be. Cast off all restraints. Totally be free. Don't listen. Don't let anybody limit you. And that should be their total goal. That's a lie. That's a lie. James says, don't you go say even what you're going to go do tomorrow. It's all based on God's will. It's a lie. And people are frustrated because that lie doesn't come true. Our children are being convinced that marriage is not worth trying because it didn't work for so many couples that they've observed. If you have close to a 50% divorce rate, well, people today are just saying, why even go through that step? I mean, forget it. We'll just live together. It doesn't work, obviously. Satan's lie. Our children are being taught to be tolerant of anything and everything. Anything goes. Anything's okay. You feel it works for you, that's fine. Demonic forces are out to destroy not only the family, not only your children. Demonic forces are out to destroy this church. This church represents Jesus Christ, and they hate it. And they are out to destroy it. They lie to us that we really don't miss church that much when we miss. I mean, if I've got something better to be entertained by on Sunday morning, another place to be, that's okay. I can opt out. By the very fact that demonic forces want us to miss church as often as possible proves that they know there's great benefits to our being here in church, studying God's word together, being built up, being encouraged and equipped to go out and be servants for Jesus Christ. Satan's demons know that, but they lie to us. Oh, it's not that important. You can miss. They do anything possible to divide the unity in our church by getting us to focus on tiny, tiny differences. Well, different preferences and different things that people say and do and think and insignificant things where our tastes do not match everyone else's taste. They delight on stirring that up and fanning that fire and making that little anthill into a mountain and dividing churches. Demonic forces are out to steal our spiritual victory. With the lie that our positional relationship to God is affected by our failures. We already mentioned that. That, you know, your life will show somehow whether you really are going to end up in heaven or not. That's a lie. These evil forces masquerade as God or as our own consciences in order to convince us that our doubts are the truth. My wife has given me permission to say this. There was a time in her life when she struggled with her assurance of salvation. And she would have these doubts in her mind, and she thought they were from God. Are you sure you're saved? Are you sure you're good enough for that? Are you sure? I mean, you don't deserve it. And these demonic forces are against her. You know, she used to wake up in the morning and say, Lonnie, I don't understand. I wake up, and I get out of bed, and the first thing I hear in my mind is, Sharon, I hate you. Where did that come from? It didn't come from her. It didn't come from me. I don't use that word ever. These are forces that are hostile to us, to our victory, to our peace. But she thought those doubts, God must be giving me these doubts and troubling so that I get in gear and get it right. And she struggled a long time until she realized they're lying. That's not what God's word says. God's word says God loves you beyond what you can imagine. He demonstrated that by sending Jesus Christ to the cross to die and pay the penalty in our place for our sin. He gives us eternal life as a free gift. He wants to have a relationship with us. Anything else is a lie. God is never the author of doubt. That's Satan. He is the accuser of the brethren and the sisters. That's a lie. And until she figured that out, and was able to rebut that and say, that thought is a lie. Satan, demonic forces, get out of here. I'm standing against that. That is not reality. That is not God's word. Until you and I can filter that out and fight that, we are going to be negatively affected by that. By getting us to compare ourselves with others so that we always feel inadequate, always comparing ourselves, that's a temptation. Bible says not to do that, but Satan is good at that, his demonic forces, and he's always putting us down by flooding us with media information so that we're totally confused and too busy to learn the real truth from God's revelation. We don't have the filter in place, and so we're just buying from this fire hose, and all these philosophies are affecting us negatively. Satan's forces convince us that God cannot use us to share the gospel, hindering us from sharing the gospel. Not you, maybe someone else, but hey, you know, you tried it one time. That person didn't put their faith in Christ. They rejected it. So aren't you smart enough? It doesn't work for you. Give it up. Satan's demonic forces are very against sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And those of you that have shared the gospel, you know the kind of hindrances he can bring up. You know, you can talk to a person about their sin, and the fact that God loves them, and their sin has a consequence, well, hell. So because of God's love, he gives them the gift of eternal life if they put their faith in Jesus Christ because of what he did for them. And they can listen to all that. But when it comes right down to the point, are you willing to believe in Jesus Christ as your only way to heaven? Wow, a switch gets flipped. I mean, things happen. The TV, the kids start to scream, a car screeches outside, the fire truck goes by. I mean, all kinds of stuff to inhibit that final choice of that person. That's spiritual warfare. Satan's good at that. He doesn't deceives us by convincing us that God cannot use us to help someone else spiritually, to encourage them, to build them up. Not you, somebody else. Somebody else needs to go do it. He'll mess it up. All of those ways he deceives us. You know, we've seen today that we are against the wiles, the strategies of the devil. We don't understand how much he hates God and God's plan and Jesus Christ and the gospel and the fact that we are Jesus Christ. He hates us. He hates our marriage. He hates our family. He hates our kids. His will would be that everybody committed suicide. He hates us. He is our enemy. He's a powerful enemy. He has all these demonic forces he's trained under his command. And we need to understand our battle is not against situations and little problems in our life that we get all hung up on. It's against spiritual forces. There's a spiritual battle going on. that has eternal consequences, and you and I are involved in it, whether we know it or not. And frankly, in this culture, Satan would rather you not even know it. And he lies to us, and he deceives us, and he holds us back, and he hinders us in all kinds of ways. And God is telling us, look, because of this process, because you have a powerful enemy, because of his deceptive practices, because of all of these demonic forces, you need to know you're in a battle, and you need to put on the armor of God, and you need to and can have victory. And that's what we're going to talk about as we go through this armor. We've seen today in part two that Satan and his demonic forces work to deceive us and hinder us from being spiritually victorious. I want to ask you, as you go out from this place, we saw this verse last time, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Ask God, ask the Holy Spirit to show you, to reveal to you, to help you figure out and understand, where are the lies that you have believed? What are those tapes? Tapes are outdated. What's that digital recording that keeps on playing in your head that hinders you? What philosophies have you agreed to, accepted? Because you and I need to be aware of those so we can confront them, stand against them. Say, that's a lie. That's not reality. I have believed this for years. That is not according to God's word. That is not truth, and I'm going to stand against it. I'm going to have victory. Let us ask God's Holy Spirit to show us how Satan's forces are stealing away our spiritual victory and what God wants us to do in our lives. Then, as we study the remainder of this passage, we want to learn how to have victory over Satan and these lies. Father, thank you for laying it all out and giving us this intelligence, this knowledge about our enemy and his strategies and how they work against us. Father, this is serious business. We are all involved in a spiritual battle, and that's the reality. And these are powerful forces, and they have lost control of us when we put our faith in Christ, but they want to pretend they have control in our life. They want to tempt us to give them control. They want us to be deceived. They want us to believe a lie that they can use against us for the rest of our life. And we need to stand against that. Father, show us, each individually, the lies that we have believed, things that we need to change in our marriages, in our families, with our children, in our neighborhoods and places of work and schools and all of this. Help us to be spiritually victorious. Help us to fight this battle as a strong warrior. You have given us the Holy Spirit to control us and give us victory. Satan is trying to prohibit and hinder and steal away that victory. And help us to realize how serious this battle is so that we can put on the armor of God and have that victory. In Jesus' name. Amen.